Well, good afternoon. Welcome to Digital Marketing Show in the Mobile Theatre, sponsored by Sitecore, customer engagement and customer experience platform. I'd like to introduce you to Alex. Alex is head of mobile at the Internet Advertising Bureau, the trade body that represents digital advertising in the UK. Main role is to make mobile mandatory for marketers, and particularly driving through research essential to education and inform the market. The one little bit thing I like here is was Media Week's 30 under 30s in 2011. Mm. So we won't guess what that meant on age-wise, but
it's not good, unfortunately.
But anyway, Alex is here to talk about today's digital customers. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Hello, everybody. Can you hear me all right? It's a bit weird. I can really hear myself, and I feel like I'm in steps. Thank you all for coming to listen to me speak today. As Brian said, I'm from the Internet Advertising Bureau. Does anybody know the Internet Advertising Bureau here? A couple of you. We've got a stand if you want to find out more. But we are a non-profit trade body representing digital advertising markets. So we're with Google, Facebook, Microsoft, 900 members to try and basically grow digital advertising in the UK. So I'm not really coming at you from any angle. I'm coming at you from a kind of nice third party, not trying to sell you anything, but just trying to really inform you. And one of the ways that we inform the market is through a lot of research. And that's what I'm going to show you today, one piece of research we've done. The name of the research piece is called RealView. It's the biggest research project we've ever done at the IAB, and it's actually not fully launched yet. It's fully launching on the 11th of December, and this is a bit of a preview as to some of the insights we got from it. Three things, basically, we saw, top things we saw coming out in the early stages of the research. But do keep an eye out if you want to see anything more. On the 11th of December, we'll be launching some full information on our website. So I'll crack on and get involved in what the presentation entails. So at the Internet Advertising Bureau, we're obviously really interested in people using the internet and how that works. And a big part of that is how people use their devices to access the internet. And something that I do specifically is work on the mobile side of the business. And you probably see that here today, right? We're all here to network, end up networking with our screens often. And I guess this piece of research, the RealView piece of research, really wanted to understand, we know this is happening, we know there's a lot of surveys out there, a lot of statistics, but kind of get underneath that and really understand how people are actually using their devices. Because if you think about when you're using your mobile phone, your tablet, and someone asks you 2 weeks later, how many times did you use your phone on January 23rd? Or what sites did you visit? Or what did you do? Where were you? It's so part of what you do, it's actually very hard to remember that type of information. So we really wanted to get under the skin beyond survey data to really understand device usage in the UK. So what we did to understand that was partner with a research agency called Firefish. And what we did with them was a really groundbreaking piece of methodology where we had fisheye cameras, 20 fisheye cameras, which captured every 5 seconds an image. And they were placed around respondents' necks for 3 days. You could turn them off before you have any bad ideas. So what you get is over a 3 day period, an image every 5 seconds being captured, what the respondent is seeing and doing, which you can build up a really nice idea of their usage patterns and where they are and who they're with and what they're doing. We also, I'll sort of carry on, but we got a lot of kind of like, well, it was a new methodology, not really seen that much of it before, about 600 hours worth of footage as a result, right? And we got a few questions like, okay, so you can turn it off, but do you really relax? Do you really kind of do as you normally would do when you have a camera around your neck? And I just want to show you one film which I think illustrates that people did actually relax quite a lot. We managed to capture some things that you maybe wouldn't expect. So this just gives you an idea of the kind of footage we got. So you can see this is from being captured from her neck, and she's in the car in her pink dressing gown, obviously driving whilst texting. All in all, doesn't seem too concerned about having a camera around her neck capturing both her pretty bad outfit and her illegal behavior. So rest assured that people kind of acted very much as normal, and that gives you an idea of what the kind of footage we collected was. We also backed it up with a bit of quant research to give it a bit of backbone. We did some interviews with those 20 respondents who had the cameras around their neck. We also did a quant survey of over 1,300 people to really, when we had the insights from the qual, from the camera footage, to really understand if it was a trend that was happening on a wider scale in the UK beyond those 20 respondents. There was one other thing we did, which I'm just going to quickly mention, which was also consult with a psychologist about this research, a psychologist called Dr. Simon Hampton, that guy, to really try and understand why people were doing this and the kind of base reasons why. And I'll try and weave in a bit of what he says into the deck to inform why these people are using the device in this way. But what I would say is if you go and read this blog, obviously I'm not an academic, he explains it far better than I do. And I would really encourage you, it's just, here's the URL, you can have a little look around our website at the same time, to really understand the kind of cognitive psychology reasons and academic theory that inform some of these consumer behaviors. So I really encourage you to do that. Does that all make sense so far? In terms of methodology? Yeah? Okay, great. So I'll go on to, as I say, tell you the three top line things we've learned so far at the very early stages of this research. The first one, we actually made up a word to describe it. And that was omniscreening. And we thought, if you're going to make a word, you might as well put a hashtag in front of it. So that's what we've done. Feel free to tweet it. So omniscreening. And what does that really mean, right, omniscreening? There's two things that make up what we are seeing and calling omniscreening as a consumer trend. The first one is this constant connectivity to your digital devices. And you probably will feel this and understand this. That there's no such thing as just downtime anymore. You're constantly turned on to your digital device. If you're waiting for the train, it's always on. And actually, it's becoming very, very socially acceptable to use it throughout conversations, to use it at the pub, when you're with other people. It's really becoming that kind of filler for any occasion. And as I mentioned, we consulted with a psychologist about this, Dr. Simon Hampton, and he said some really interesting things about it. He said that they've done some studies of how primitive humans, I guess, used to hold tools for hunting and for, I don't know, doing their business, right? And actually, they held their tools in very much the same way that we hold our mobile phones now. And that these mobile phones are becoming such an important tool for us. They're much used in the same way as the kind of primitive man was. And actually, it's becoming an extension of self. And that has big implications for the second point about how we use it when in a social setting. It's becoming less and less socially unacceptable and rude to play with your phone whilst in conversation. In the same way, it's not considered rude to play with your hair or play with your hands whilst talking to someone. It's so much a part of self that it's kind of becoming that constant connectivity and an extension of the body, which I think is quite fascinating and a little bit scary. So some interesting findings in the way we as humans are adapting, and we have adapted to many other tools before this, and we continue to adapt to devices. And I'm just going to show you a video, again, from the footage we collected of exactly how this is working for consumers. So if we move on.
I think as regards to having it on me all the time is my phone. I forget it. I don't really treat it as a media in my head. I don't really treat it. It's a part of me in a way. It's just there. It's in my hand all the time. If I need it, it's there.
I don't know if you can hear what he's saying, but he's saying I've got it on me all the time. He's in the pub. You can see everyone in the pub captured on his fisheye camera, using the phone. This is a lady with her husband having lunch, or not really, more having lunch with her phone by the looks of things, and. That kind of constant use throughout who she's talking about.
I must have been bored.
So again, I don't know if you heard that, but she's saying, I must have been bored. So she didn't even realise at the time that she was really doing that throughout lunch with her husband until she was interviewed afterwards and drawn attention to it, that she was actually constantly checking her phone and such an extension of herself that she didn't really even know she'd done it. So that's the first bit of omniscreening. Secondly, we've seen some really interesting insights in the amount of multi-screening, dual screening going on. So again, this might have been something you've heard about, especially with TV. We hear a lot about mobile and tablet being used in conjunction with TV. What we actually saw is that almost 98% of people do multi-screen in some way, but we saw an awful lot of people multi-screening between digital devices. It's not just with TV. They actually quite often have a laptop, a tablet, and a mobile all working together at the same time, which I was quite surprised by. It's not something that I do personally, but 51% of people are doing that, and actually the largest amount of cross-screening going on. And there's a real kind of driver for entertainment, constant need for constant information, which is informing that that kind of consumer trend. So I'll just play you another video of that. Now, I don't know if I can try and get the sound up. I don't know. Yeah, we'll give it a go.
So I'm researching one of the user websites on the Kindle and one on the desktop, and I'll just be comparing them both side of each other.
I'll just be clear.
So instead of just like shutting it down or minimizing.
So he's saying he's researching here, and you can see his Kindle alongside his computer.
Time or just
shopping.
Instead of shutting down, opening up. I've got.
And what he's saying is, I can do two things at once. I can do things alongside each other, compare stuff. Again, having one task, two screens. And this is another example of this kind of constant flitting between screens. So you see that, and having your Kindle, your phone up at the same time, just constantly flitting around. So, again, we consulted with our psychologist friend on this project to understand a bit about this. And actually, he made a really good point, is the concept of multi-screening or has been around forever. There's nothing really new about human behavior. And he referred back to this kind of image of the 1940s household listening to a radio, right? And actually, just as much then as now, the radio or the TV are the kind of social gathering points for why people get in a room together. But actually, since then, people are doing a multitasking or multi-screening, right? It's nothing new going on here in terms of human behavior. It's just a new device to do it on. And actually, this opens up some really exciting opportunities for marketers, and we actually have a chance to grab their attention back, whereas before they might have been playing with games. At least we can talk to them in new ways, and not to be afraid of this kind of not a new human behavior. It's not something we should fear, but something we should embrace and kind of open up to. So those two things together, the fact that we're seeing no downtime and this amazing amount of multi-screening, we combine those to make it omni-screening, always present, loads of different screens all the time. And I think a really interesting trend that you may or may not identify with personally. I know I certainly do. You might see it on the trains. And something we expect to see a lot more of. All make sense so far? Yeah? Okay. So that was the first insight we saw. Second one was more about the purchasing habits of people with smartphones and how that's changing. So one really interesting thing we've seen is, I kind of mentioned it earlier, this constant need for information and content. Consumers are demanding an awful lot out of their devices. They Twitter, constantly looking for information. And actually, you might expect they'll go to Twitter or a news site or an entertainment site for some kind of information to keep them going, right? But actually, what's really interesting we saw out of this research is that a lot of people are shopping as a way of finding content and expect their shopping outlets, especially online, to provide a lot of content. And they're doing it as a boredom filler. So if you're a retailer, that makes a big difference to the way you communicate with people through your website. You see people like ASOS doing a very good job of being actually almost a magazine, almost a content provider in themselves, feeding that need for content and kind of benefiting off the back of it. So people are going to their phone and their digital devices to get content from the people they're shopping from. And I've got one video, but just to explain it a bit further, what that means is that often the smartphone is the first place they interact with a brand. It means if they see something they're interested in buying, the first thing they pick up will be their phone. So they're looking for content on their phone, and when they're actually thinking about the next step of buying it, it will still be their phone that fulfills that need. So I'll play this video again, and I'll try and speak over it if it doesn't work.
See an advert in a magazine on the iPhone, Google, sections, swimming costumes, bikinis, tankinis, and just get a bit of an estimate of prices.
So she's seen a swimming costume in the magazine, picking up her phone.
Change different angles, a larger image, etc. So because that's just a flat image, you can't really get that much of an idea.
saying by looking at, so she sees a one-dimensional picture in her in the magazine, picks up her phone to see the colours, to see the different angles, to see more information. Really good example, actual real-life example of the smartphone being the first point of contact for someone's purchase experience. But that has some interesting implications for marketers and how we use that communications on smartphones. We know that they're really personal devices, right? And it doesn't mean we can kind of go straight in there, bulldozing down, and bombarding them with information. And actually, we kind of equate this to a bit like a first date, right? You don't want to, on the first date, be too full on with your communications, right? You're gonna scare the other person off. It's a bit of a softly approach. And so likewise, when communicating with someone through the smartphone, it's the softly approach, and this data backs that up. So if you make a comparison to a purchase of an item to being the first date happening, actually, people are much happier to hear from you after that first date and much more open to communications. So I think the lesson is here, we know it's their first point of contact, but not to be too full on at that point. To let them kind of get acquainted with your brands and then kind of pick up on those communications later on and be very aware of how personal that device is. So the third of the kind of top line insights we saw out of the RealView research was around categories. This is really interesting because if any of you have ever been involved in any media planning before, you'll know that often demographics are the lead way to categorize and target individuals who are your target audience. And actually in this, we saw a bit of kind of contrasting information that challenges this. So this is the only slide with charts on it, so bear with me, I'm going to explain it. We're looking here at how people research, kind of trigger to find out more, and then actually purchase items across three different categories. Across a low, medium, and high category. So a low interest category might be something like a grocery shop, Kit Kat bar, something like that, fairly cheap item. A medium category might be clothing, DVD, something a bit more in the mid-price range, and a high item value might be a white goods, fridge, TV, or something like that, right? So we're looking across these categories and across different age groups and demographics here, key demographics that we pulled out, how they research for those items, yeah? And the level of usage that they're using their devices to do that. So here you can see, as you might expect, as a category goes up in value, as an item goes up in value, here, in this case, the young people, they're relying on their digital devices to research that more heavily, right? If you overlay the rest of the other demographics on here, you can see that actually the trends are much the same, right? And actually, that's quite unusual for graphs like this. Normally, when you look at any graph that has target audiences split out like that, you see more like different lines with older people acting in different ways, younger people, men and women acting very differently. And actually, that applies to pretty much throughout the purchase process, that the category is the thing that makes the most difference in how people are purchasing, how people are using digital devices. It kind of trumps the demographic. So again, another really important learning for marketers and the way they use digital devices to communicate with their audiences, that actually a young person might act much the same way as a 55 plus, but it's the category, it's what they're buying that dictates how you should communicate with them. So it's a bit of a kind of thought reprocessing them. And this video, hopefully, will show that the difference between a young man kind of showrooming and an older woman, they do it in much the same way, for different items, but in much the same way.
There's some stuff that I'll see on like the computer, and then I'll be on the bus or something, and then I'll just be there, like, I'll have another quick look at it on my phone. So I am going from like device to device, looking at the same thing. I'd look at it on the internet, but then I'd go to a shop to have a look.
I went in to just have a quick walk. I wasn't necessarily going to buy anything, but then I'd seen previously that blouse on, I think it was either in, on, there it is. See it? Mm-hmm. Yes. I saw it, thought, yes, it's there. I'd seen that on, it must have been maybe an email or something. I'd seen it with a picture of a woman wearing it. And you can't get that now, it's gone.
So totally different demographics there, but researching on their phones, going in store, buying. Not everyone will do that, but it just shows you can't make any assumptions that that older lady won't be looking at what she's getting through digital communications and then kind of acting on it. And that often happens, that we think it's only the 18 to 24s who are really the target audience who are engaging here. And our research quite clearly shows that it's not. So those are the three kind of top line insights I was going to show you today. Just to conclude, hashtag omniscreening, obviously. So we're seeing this kind of constant, always on consumer who is plugged into not only one device, and not only when they've got, you know, at work or a bit of time to themselves, but they've got many devices they're plugged into all the time. In social situations, when they're on their own, whenever, they are omniscreening. What's really interesting to see is that shopping is now not just the place where you go and check out, but actually where people are looking for content to entertain themselves and are looking for a new content all the time, which again, if you're a retailer, has a massive impact on your website strategy and how, and your content strategy and how you speak to your consumers. We also know that the first thing that people pick up when they see something they're interested in is their mobile phone. So being open, having the shop doors open on your mobile phone, is on your mobile presence, is so important. But to be quite careful with the communications you put through that. You don't want to be too full on. Treat it like a first date. When you built up the trust with one of your with your consumers, then you can give a bit more, but not to go too far on such a personal device too early on. And lastly, really understanding your category and specifically how that category works on digital, as we know, demographics aren't kind of all we think it is. And so my last slide is just to show if there's brands here, I guess it can be quite scary sometimes, and I kind of refer back to the psychologist who in that blog I mentioned that there's nothing that's ever new, right? These are our core human behaviors, and we shouldn't be afraid of it as a marketing community. This is actually a great opportunity, and it's kind of a bit Sheryl Sandberg, it's a bit lean in, right? So don't be afraid of these opportunities, and don't worry, but actually lean into it and make the most of it. Step forward and take control of the time that people are spending with your site, with your presence, with your digital kind of activities. Take control. That's it. There's an area of our website if you want to find out a bit more. You're welcome to contact me. There's my email address. And I don't know if there's any questions or.
I was just about to ask, is there any questions before people start thinking and quickly put their hand up? I've got one.
Sure, yeah.
You said you got a launch of this survey coming out the 11th?
Yeah.
Yeah. So one thing I want to ask, you talked about the categories that you had and your expectation was a lot more diverse.
Yeah.
And obviously you're just giving us a snapshot of what you've done. Were there any other categories that were diverse that are going to be launched on the 11th? And are we going to see that information?
Yeah,
or is
yeah.
it all pretty much?
We'll be releasing category-specific information. And actually, even though we found that category was more important than demographics, we know that people are really interested in demographics. So we'll be releasing category-specific information and audience-specific information so that depending on your kind of interest, you can really get into the data and kind of find out a bit more.
Brilliant. Yeah. Thank you. Any questions from anybody else? No? Okay, well, I'd like to thank Alex, and look out on the 11th. Thank you.
Thank you very much, everybody.